The presentations that will be done during the session will be focused on very specific experiences of online commissioning, hosting, distributing, and archiving artistic projects and artworks that are either specifically produced or also adapt for digital support and online circulation. And these presentations will consider the forms of relations with digital means and the possibilities that may exist beyond their online circulation and also their spatial and physical displays. And I will do a very, very short abstract of the presentations by the order in which they will be done. So opening Zachary Kaplan will reflect on the change to professional and institutional identities that have been brought about by the evolution of institutional relations to digital networks. And he will focus on some initiatives and, of course, on Rhizome's own mode of work and of functioning. Lauren Boyle will give a brief introduction of this as an artistic, curatorial and editorial collective, and she will focus in particular on the possibilities that a project that attempts to invent other modes of publishing, of commissioning, and of exhibiting can offer, and she will highlight several recent initiatives. And this, between brackets, hopefully also something in relation to Berlin and to the recent project in Paris, but this is my wish list. Then we have Cecile B. Evans will discuss some recent projects, and in particular, as Eva has mentioned, Agnes, which was her commission for the Serpentine in 2014, and also Talk to Phil, which sees a digital dummy of Philip Seymour Hoffman as the narrator of Hyperlinked or It Didn't Happen, and also her more recent contributions for this is curated exhibition at the Musée d'Art Moderne in Paris, Co-workers, Networkers, Artists, which you can see until the end of January if you happen to go to Paris. And in doing so, she will consider various institutional modes and also problematics when dealing with digital means. And Susan Pfeffer will consider the curatorial concepts and theoretical grounding of her exhibition Triology, Speculations on Anonymous Materials, Nature After Nature, and Inhuman, which also featured Cecile's Hyperlinked work, which was an exhaustive project of investigation of how our lives are being affected by technology, from, namely, the changes in interpersonal relations, alterations to labor and consuming, and advances in science in general and in neuroscience, for instance. And in the most recent years, of course, I think we all agree that we've assisted to a large growth of diverse artistic initiatives, institutional and not, that use digital means to conceive and host projects and the internet to circulate them. They can generally assume as formats as the archive-like platforms that accumulate and preserve contents under the same large umbrella. And Rhizome's Artbase, which exists since 1999, is a wonderful example of this, containing over 2,500 digital artworks. It can also be live streaming as Tate Live or punctual live simulations as some of the Serpentine commissions or other online live events. Periodical features that stay online for a given relatively short period and are subsequently removed as Vidro, self-promotion a little bit, apologies for that, or open source collaborative networks. But also they can be online residencies, online galleries, online education activities, and email-based content distribution, which can be hosted either on entirely dedicated websites or extensions of pre-existing websites or supports that combine digital means, internet access, and physical spaces. Yet digital artistic uses can be traced as far as the late 1970s, with, for instance, we often quote it as one of the first works that was entirely thought for a digital support as Roy Ascott's La Plaisure du Texte, no? From 83, which was a sort of fairy tale online international experience of an exquisite corpse, or Chris Marker's Dialecta, made also in the 1980s, just to name a few. and the survival and possibility of existence in the presence of these works can help us also to imagine what the future of the contents that we've produced and that we're producing and managing nowadays can be or will be, which is something that those who are invested in presenting artistic projects that rely on the internet or on digital supports are also very invested in considering. At the same time, as we think about preservation and migration, it would be interesting to understand how online communities have shifted intellectual, artistic, and cultural debates to the blogosphere as this medium emerged in the opening decade of this century, and how art institutions, museums, but also publications, curatorial, artistic initiatives, and others have responded and followed such wake. If before the early 2000s, most people would rarely meet those whose texts they read and whose artworks they saw in exhibitions and magazines, nowadays, that lack of physical encounter is still a reality. And yet, many of those whose work we read, whose work we see online, and whose different elements we encounter is discussed and commented in an online and collective community of people. So there's a very interesting transition in this fact. And online platforms can be extremely productive places for debate and for experimentation as the less formal institutional frame, because they facilitate immediate reactions to research, with authors sharing their ideas in their initial stages of development. And here, not in an artistic frame, but I think many of us know how, for instance, the developments done to speculative realism have been so much relying on the internet, and how many of their authors have sustained that the developments to their own theories have been made possible via their sharing of the contents and their almost live development of their ideas. And also, they open itself to collaboration with open access forms of sharing, and they accelerate the traditional slower rhythm of reviews, allowing for almost instant reactions to events, to works, to images, to sounds, to opinions, so on and so forth. Yet it seems that some of the most significant spaces for exchange and dialogue are not necessarily the institutional ones, as many of these projects bypass the logics of copyright, economical values of cultural capital, and any legitimizing frames that can exist within an institutional platform. And I think it would be also interesting to understand or to discuss how institutions are reacting and learning from such initiatives and are thinking their own identities, online and not, thanks to the ways that people have found to communicate, to circulate their ideas, their projects, and to diffuse their materials, and by making also artworks online and with digital means. So hopefully we will manage in 1.5 hours to go through this. And I just thank you for your attention, and I'll pass the word to Zachary. Thank you.
The topic today happens to be the focus of my current project at Rhizome, which is this book to be released by Sternberg Press in 2016 on the occasion of Rhizome's 20th anniversary, which makes us quite old for the web, the Met of sorts. The book, as was alluded to earlier, sorts through institutionality after digital networks, from digital strategy of places like the Met through institutions like Rhizome that are based fully on the internet. And it deals with problems general to, I think, all institutions, like just dealing with digital dualism or dealing with this online-offline kind of living through the device that I'm reading my notes off of, but also like very specific topics to people working with digital art, such as the fragility of digital objects. And it features, I guess I'll read the artists who are based here, or writers who are based here, but Hannah Black, Ben Vickers, Katrina Sluice, Harry Burke, my colleagues at Rhizome, Arit Gott, Michael Connor, Dragon Espenscheid, our former executive director, Heather Corcoran, and many others. I think the impulse for the project, not only because this is a conversation that could happen during freeze, is this general kind of skepticism with how the digital has been institutionalized as marketing gimmicks or as kind of like a reformatting of administration roles, that kind of thing. And also as like a historical break as opposed to a continuity in how institutions have been transforming since their origin. Rather, the kind of premise of the publication is really fundamental. It's just answering in kind of a collective way by looking at a lot of different people, how do digital networks require institutions to fully reorder themselves? And to begin to kind of illustrate, oh, whoa, there's some crazy thing happening here. To begin to illustrate that, I mean, I guess it's good to look at, this is my thing, it's good to look at Rhizome, which since 1996 has been trying to answer this question and relate to these problems. As you can see, Rhizome is a born digital art institution supporting contemporary art that creates richer and more critical digital cultures. And we've been based online since 1996, and we've had an affiliation with the New Museum, a really interesting organizational model, in fact, since 2003. By putting kind of born digital in this, in our kind of mission statement, we're indicating that, you know, digital networks are key to our point of view. And I should say that when I'm referring to digital networks, I'm talking about an ensemble that's technical, material, and social, rapidly globalizing, but at various paces, and challenging contemporary living in many ways. So the internet as like a document delivery system, but also precarious labor on Uber or you know, art on Instagram. We have a great Instagram residency by a young artist named Giovanna Almos right now at rhizome.org, but also, you know, the painting that's taken a picture of by an influential curator, and then its value changes because of that. And so how are these, how is this ensemble asking networks to change? And you know, I think a little bit of, we're always asked to talk about post-internet, and I can, and there was like a good line from Ben Vickers, our colleague here at the Serpentine, about post-internet, its card to play being challenging the gallery as just a single node in the network. And I think that that's pretty precise about post-internet as an idea, but also about institutionality today. Networks ask us to question our network positions, to recognize networks, both digital and analog, in that ensemble, and relate to them. And I think, you know, that original relation, you know, was read as kind of like a challenge to institutionality. You know, this kind of gatekeeper problem, which kept coming up, and this idea that the network would kind of end authorization or something like that. And on the contrary, what we've seen is a proliferation of institutionality. And I think it's really exciting. We define being an institution as being a fixed point, as a point of stability, as a point of memory. And when you kind of think about institutionality in those terms, and you start to break down the wall of what you kind of thought, you know, Rhizome was initially and who its peers were, it gets kind of interesting and pretty broad and very exciting. That memory is like ever present, but also intensely fragile. So I should stop being so theoretical and talk about Rhizome itself. So Rhizome's a good answer to this question. What do we do? Well, we support the creation of new works of art. This is a piece by a young artist named Lena NW, which is this game kind of based on Kim Kardashian's game on iPhone. And it's called Viral. She's great, but it's a great project, and us kind of supporting an artist at the earliest moments in their career. We also commission things that are, you know, in a space. So this was Anne Hirsch's Playground, which I think also had a presentation here, and maybe some of you in the room saw it, but it's this kind of semi-autobiographical two-person play about Anne kind of coming into early life via AOL chat rooms. We support the creation of new works kind of through our events as well. We have this flagship program called 7on7 that brings together artists and tech people to create something new. This is Jacob Applebaum and Ai Weiwei collaborating on a project for this year's 7on7, and in a film captured by Laura Poitras, who made Citizen 4 last year. And this event also allows us to intervene in the tech space in an interesting way. So this is just an example. This is a startup that kind of came out of 7on7 called Monograph, which is a digital authentication startup that works via blockchain technology. And actually on the 22nd, next Thursday, we'll have an event kind of thinking about horizons for blockchain technology that will be broadcast online as well, so if you're interested. We present art as well, and this has been consistent since our earliest moments. We have an online exhibition series with a new museum called First Look, and it's currently a project curated by my colleague Michael Connor, who many of you probably know, and it's about digital painting for the web. So I think if you go to Frieze right now, you can see how much the digital gesture has been translated to the gallery. But this is kind of returning to artists who are making work for LiveJournal, for Tumblr. This is Laura Brothers. We produce a journal. And then finally, as alluded to earlier, we have this art base of more than 2,000 born digital art objects. And this is really exciting for us because it's a collection that kind of challenges what a collection is. I mean, we, like artists, have assigned their work in exchange for kind of us being working to maintain it. And because of that, this collection is not about the distribution of objects necessarily to other places or but really, it's like a lab for us to maintain and think about how digital artifacts, which are intensely fragile, are preserved. And I'll kind of touch back at that at the end. And we're just one example. So I should just say, the book has a lot of these thematic essays, and then it also has a collection of capsules on interesting organizational models. And I think with the rest of my talk, I'm just going to talk through some of those and explain how their identity reflects like certain network dispositions in relation to digital networks, or what it means to be at once IRL and URL today. So what does it look like? I mean, I think that, you know, from the earliest days of the web as like a document delivery system, this idea of discursivity has been very important, thinking about how information circulates. Of course, NetTime, founded in 1995, a year before us, is a great example of this, creating kind of digital culture and ideas around digital culture before digital culture as a term perhaps even existed. And this is like a very simple kind of mailing list, but fundamental to kind of the field of born digital art institutions. And it's very specific, you know, it's bespoke and politically minded, and it's hosting, lightly moderated. That's like a major change with how we might build something today, but remains quite influential. Of course, we can mention Lunch Bites as a kind of a discursive institution, and founded by Melanie, and thank you for having me again. And this is obviously a series of live conversations, which are then, you know, circulated online for free. But, you know, that incarnation, or that impulse to kind of intervene in discursive circulation is central to its premise. Other kind of things like this, MoMA R&D, which I don't know if anyone here has had a chance to see, but founded by Paolo Antonelli in 2012 at the Museum of Modern Art. This is really interesting because, you know, when the Museum of Modern Art as an institution does anything, it has such an effect on the field at large. And this kind of invite-only salon series is this kind of creative intervention into like trying basically to seed conversations at a certain level where MoMA as a big institution can participate in a small way and non-monolithically. And then 89 Plus is another example of this kind of intervention into this discourse, you know, taking the form here. If, you know, MoMA R&D is about the invite-only salon, this is all about the top-level thought leadership conference, DLD, Museum Next, these kind of things. And also the database is really interesting that they're building. Some institutions, of course, don't want to take that top level and want maybe to be more evasive. And Vault is a great example of this, the Berlin-based, physically based in Berlin, initiated by artist designers in 2013, and taking various forms across built environments and book form and online. And really thinking about the entire project of being an institution as an interface through which people, ideas, and artworks move. This is also where I'd probably put in Bubble Byte as well, but since Opening Times has a bit of a presence here, I'll let the work speak for itself. So that's kind of discursive, evasive. I'm also really interested in these kind of vernacular institutions. So this is something that I'm sure everyone here recognizes. But Vork is a WordPress blog started by artists with images, some video, minimal captioning. This is actually something we just preserved at Rhizome. It's exhibition at its most casual and surprisingly controversial. It's applied narratives. And yeah, I mean, it's somewhere you have to start with thinking about what it means to show vernacularly and broadening this idea of what an institution even is today to the vernacular web. A more kind of current incarnation, or still live incarnation, is this Black Contemporary Art Tumblr. Okay, yeah, I'm good, I'm coming to an end. Which is by Kimberly Drew, who's works at the Met currently. But it was this kind of Tumblr that was created to circulate images of, as she put it, art created by artists of African descent. And it was produced on Tumblr, which is very different than producing something on WordPress. So if WordPress was all about the kind of known audience visiting, you know, verk.org, Black contemporary art is all about a dashboard viewing experience and the kind of circulation of these images. Not only are they viewed, but then they're reblogged, picked up, circulated. The narrative is as much done by a public as it is by the individual posting originally. Of course, and the last kind of section, it's kind of a bit of a, these institutions that are challenging kind of the nonprofit space. And of course, this is a place where maybe I would put DIS as well. But taking up, kind of thinking about interventions into commerce, Eflux is a great example of this, founded in 1998, and which has massively reordered the art world through this kind of for-profit structure. And there's a great essay in the book about Eflux and its relationship to audiences internationally, written by my colleague Uri Gott. I'm really excited about that. And then finally, I just want to talk about this kind of like interventionist category. So Rhizome has been affiliated with the New Museum in 2003, and they've always had a really kind of interesting approach to their institutionality. One of the things they created last year was this thing called New Inc., which is the first museum-led incubator for art, tech, and design projects. So Rhizome is an anchor tenant here, and this is a kind of space where artists, designers, startups kind of work together in a co-working environment, share resources, et cetera. And I think it's really interesting that New Museum would be taking up this challenge to work in this space by actually just creating the workplace itself and trying to influence through kind of cultural osmosis and direct kind of address these things, apps, devices, practices that are changing the way we live. And actually, Rhizome now is based here, and we're kind of thinking about it in the same way. And one of the most exciting places where we've been working, I think this will come up in our conversation, is digital preservation. And this is digital preservation and our kind of work in it is a place where I think the New Inc. context is really interesting, because we're interested as an organization for our next 20 years, you know, perhaps using the kind of research that we do into our own work and our own collections to actually create things that can be used by other people. So we recently came into a relationship with this tool called Web Recorder, which allows you to capture dynamic websites. It's really interesting, and basically, in short, the web used to be a document delivery system, and you could download a page, you know, that kind of thing. And it was, I mean, these are issues with plugins, that kind of thing, but in general, it was a document delivery system. Today, applications are delivered via browser, and Web Recorder is kind of a visionary solution to that problem of how do you save something that has no static page? You know, how do you save an artwork on Facebook when there is no Facebook.com, per se? And it is just this kind of interesting way that Rhizome, as it leads into its next few years, is thinking about taking on this interventionist identity. I mean, we'll touch back on this in the conversation, but I just wanted to thank you for listening, and I'm excited to be here.
So this talk is basically, it's DIS for Dummies. I'm just gonna assume that no one here has ever heard of DIS or DIS magazine for the sake of this talk. So what is DIS? This is really the most difficult question for us because there is no elevator pitch. It's not that easy for us to define. And if we could, maybe it wouldn't be so interesting for us. We're not editors, we're not photographers, we're not curators, and we're not even comfortable calling ourselves an art collective most of the time. We kind of assume these roles, but we aren't professionals in any of them, and I think that gives us a kind of like freedom and maybe even like naivete to everything that we approach. Our cultural interventions, they basically manifest across a range of media and platforms, but most notably probably DIS Magazine, an online platform that examines art, fashion, music, technology, while supporting and creating new creative practices, basically. It was founded in 2010 by a group of friends living in New York. It was kind of like born out of this endless email thread, and it sought to, I guess, like challenge basically the certain conventions of what a magazine structure could be used for. It's kind of, an ongoing exchange and collaborative project. It's different from, I think, like the exhibition process. It's different from simply featuring artists on a magazine. It generates something else through the commissioning process. So we kind of, I guess what we say is we react to the moment, and that's represented in the issues and the features that we publish on DIS Magazine. And it also, I guess it generates Yeah, I mean, from there we have other projects. We make videos, we do stock image sites, we you know, we're curating a biennial at this point. We throw parties, you know, it really just depends what we're faced with. So essentially, I think DIS is kind of where value systems and everything else is not overtly analyzed or critiqued, but it's represented in its most heightened configuration. Like that. And this is a great picture because, you know, for us, this is a funny image first, you know? It could be an artwork second, but really it's just, it was a funny image, and that's kind of the kind of, I guess, like the provocation of it, you know? And funny isn't necessarily, being unserious in the art world isn't necessarily, you know, respected, I think. But yeah, so what we call reacting to the moment, it's not really guided by any kind of particular ideology, which makes articulating an agenda difficult at times. We often work with ambiguity about neither nor and both thinking. So we take this as kind of a third way of approaching the situation. We embrace contradiction, and we explore our own kind of internal conflicts and conflicts of interest, like being an artist and a consumer. In general, I think we sort of reject ideas of this kind of like isolationist originality in favor of an ease of distribution and a more collaborative approach. So working together as a collective, but also with a revolving door cast of friends, is really emblematic of, I think, a broader cultural transition from do it yourself to do it with others. So over time, DIS has morphed and grown limbs. Now it's kind of a collective that serves as an umbrella to DIS Magazine, but also DIS Images and DIS Own, among other projects. So I guess we're here because a lot of what we do is build platforms for activity or cooperation. This is the homepage to DIS Images, which is a fully operational stock agency that enlists artists to produce images available for private and commercial use. And I think, I mean, this is a great example because we were asked to, it was a Rhizome commission first, but then it took us a while to get it together, and when we were invited by Suzanne Geis to do a show in New York, we were like, well, that's amazing, you know, we'd love to do a show, but we had no work to show, and we didn't really even have the means to produce new work because of certain other limitations in our lives. So what we decided to do was make the gallery into a studio and create a production line of images and invite other artists to participate. Because oftentimes what we find is like, I don't know, I mean, I think when we want to do something, we kind of think other people might want to do it too, you know? So we like to include as many people as possible sometimes. So DIS Images is dedicated to, I guess, manipulating the codes and the trends in stock photography. We've always been attracted to the weirdness and the ubiquity of stock imagery. The generic, the homogeneous banality, and also the hyper-specificity of what happens when you just mix way too many tags. And also, of course, like the way that I think stock images seem to synthesize our economic, political, cultural, and emotional landscapes into sellable products that are representational yet infinitely versatile. So with the launch of disimages.com was the corresponding stock issue, and that's something that we do a lot. A lot of times we have a project that's kind of IRL, but then we have an online project that goes along with it, complementing it. And one of my favorite projects that came out of that was this commission where we asked like 9 different artists and producers to create music based, like inspired by stock music, essentially. So this is an image from the installation of DISOWN. So DISOWN is kind of an ongoing retail platform that commissions artists to make consumer products. We call it the belts and underwear version of art because, like, you know, like every luxury brand has to make perfume and belts and underwear, and that's like how they make their real money, you know? So it was kind of this about mass, you know? It was an attempt also to rethink the conventional form of exhibition. And so we launched this at Red Bull Studios, New York, and built it as like a retail shop disguised as an exhibition, or maybe the other way around. It featured work of over 30 artists, and you know, it kind of served as a sort of laboratory to test the current status of the art object, as well as notions of taste and consumerism. So I'll just go through a couple of these catchy little products, all available online. like this Witness sweatshirt by Ryan and Lizzie, or the Whistleblower Beanie Flower Pot by The Jogging. And this is an image from that's from the install, yeah. But then we also, you know, I think a lot of artists like working with us too, because like we kind of try and go above and beyond, you know? So like if they give us a product, then we do a photo shoot and we make this out of it, you know? Or we decide that we're gonna, you know, like if they premiere a video with us or something like that, we try and make it really special, you know, for them. So these are some Tamir Sequin curtains. And these were really super popular, the corporate sweatsuit, John Raffman body pillows. Yeah, I know, it's good. So for our art school issue, we put together a story that we called Competing Images, in which we explored ways of documenting art in an attention economy. So for this, we went up to Bard at the invitation of Agatha Wara, and we spent the day shooting basically like alternative installation shots of Tamir Sechin and Katia Nova Scotia's show. I think there's like, you know, there's a kind of beauty to the life of art when it hangs on pristine walls in a controlled environment with no visitors. But what happens when, you know, you take a picture with the life around the art under absurd or quotidian circumstances? So We continued this at Freeze in 2012, actually, for Freeze projects, and we shot inside the booths before the fair opened. And it was kind of exciting for us because it was this sort of like non-consensual collaboration with the artist pictured. So we were interested in what happens to the documentation of art when it also includes the people whom it is supposed to reflect, who gather to engage it, to manage it, who themselves have a multitude of representations, concerns, distractions, agendas, and allegiances. So as far as disc goes, it kind of comes from a different time when emerging practices needed visibility. And I think this is no longer, it's not the same, you know, it's not the same case anymore. So we need to shift out of the like content visibility game into something new, something more beneficial to the flux of individuals involved and their often non-commercial practices. I don't have an answer for that, so don't ask. But we're gonna figure it out. So we work, you know, I think just generally we work pretty promiscuously across many platforms with many partners, and we encourage transactions between people who have no reason to collaborate. And I think it's fair to say that we kind of arrived here not through traditional means, but rather just a sort of collective spirit that drove us to make things happen. With the launch of Disc Magazine, we didn't exactly expect this, but we built an audience, and once we had an audience, that gave us a kind of autonomy and a freedom to do what we wanted. Yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Okay, so I thought I'd start with a project that some of you might be familiar with, which is Agnes, which was an invitation from Ben Vickers, curator of digital at the Serpentine Galleries. And it was their first digital commission, and Ben and I had been discussing for about 2 years about the value of subjective language and how that had really just caught on fire. And 2 years later, at the time of the invitation, when he came to me, I was really interested in pinpointing an interface. So the point at which these things are exchanged, what is done with that, and why. And I wanted to give that interface a voice. So I created Agnes for them. Agnes is a spam bot who lives on the Serpentine Gallery's website. And within the mythology of the work has lived on the Serpentine Gallery's servers at the Langstone Technology Park for about 15, 16, 17 years now. And when you arrive at the website, the goal of Agnes is to share her thoughts and feelings about the place that she lives. For example, she introduces you to members of staff, and based on where you decide to go with it, she will tell you information about them, but also she will tell you information about herself, such as the cat that she owns that lives in the Serpentine Gallery's basement. Various other things. She'll talk about her issues with IBM Watson. There are entire threads where she just gathers and gathers and gathers more information from you, and at some point just gives up because she understands her limitations and doesn't understand ethically why she has done this. So in that same vein of her speaking about her own condition, and in the sense that from the beginning I really wanted this to transgress this idea of online versus offline, etc., she did all of her interviews. So for example, this is her speaking with Hans-Ulrich Obrist, the co-director. Another way that was done is in one of those user journeys where she understands her limitations. She tries to match the specifications that you give her, such as are you male or female, so on and so forth, where you're from, with artists from the history of the Serpentine Galleries, and is unable to match precisely if you are anything other than male and white. And sends you a literal token in the mail as an apology, but also to try and bridge the gap between these two things. And these are tweets of people who have received tokens from Agnes and then tweeted about it. So the next step was that the Kunstverein Munich approached me and said that they wanted to invite Agnes, not me, to participate in a group exhibition called La Voix Humaine, and about our dependency on technology and also Agnes's dependency on humans. So I created a video in which Agnes admits that she has overheard at the Serpentine Galleries that there will be an end to her, and that there's a chance she might be deleted. And the film kind of follows her existential crisis of where she's going to go, how are people going to find her. And this was live streamed within the exhibition, and has since moved on to participate in other exhibitions each time. So after that happened, and this is where it all starts to get even more of a durational piece, really, is that the Serpentine Galleries kind of went back to me and said, what next? And so they re-invited Agnes to do a live event in which she was able to stream her video and confront Ben Vickers about whether or not he was actually going to delete her, but also answer questions from the audience. Their responses to their experience with her. And I think at this point, it's interesting for me to reveal something that most people had kind of caught on to, which was that Agnes is not a traditional artificial intelligence. She's more of a mechanical Turk in the sense that she's a series of human decisions that are made, and there is a very large human task force behind her. So for example, at the live event, we were a team of up to 5 people in the control booth, kind of manning Agnes. And this is actually the Google Doc that was up when people were asking questions. And this was important to me because I really wanted to experience and feel people in one room really communicating in both the online and the offline spaces.
Good this afternoon, user number 7. That was a joke. I have no idea which user number you are. I can leave that to the analytics. I do have some questions for you today, but it would be great to know how you're feeling. Could you please select the gesture that best describes you today?
So this is actually one of her most recent phases, which is Agnes Gets Archived. We were discussing the best way to archive Agnes, which is problematic because since she has, her prophecy has come true. She has been moved. She is more difficult to find on the website. And also the internet will eventually change and will no longer have a place for her. So how do we archive her? And of course they generously offered to take care of that. But for me, that wasn't in line with the user-based nature of the project. So at the moment she's at the Künstlerhaus Bremen. And we downloaded a plugin into the system, and that automatically takes, you know, a screen, it's called Screencastify, that records their user journeys. But this has been really problematic because, as you can see in the upper right-hand corner, at some point the camera records them. It doesn't, the machine doesn't always do what we want them to. So now I'm really trying to find ways to make that easy for users to be able to be a part of the archival process. And I should mention, in line with the project, each user who archived was paid with a cup of coffee at the place down the street. Agnes was also featured in Hyperlinks or It Didn't Happen, a video of which the narrator was Phil, a digital copy of an actor who had recently deceased. And as part of the second installation of the film, I ran a chat platform in which you could actually talk to Phil and have a conversation with him about his digital life and the conditions and exactly who he is, and as he introduces you to some of his non-human agent friends. And this has happened so far in Kiev, in Switzerland, and New York. And it's been really interesting to watch as, like, an audience in Kiev did not respond to this at all. They're very skeptical about technology. They felt very uncomfortable sitting in an institution chatting with Phil, versus Switzerland, where we let people do it at home. And we had 400 to 500 independent users, sometimes the conversations lasting up to an hour and a half. And similarly to Agnes, it's not a traditional artificial intelligence. It was a team of up to 6 performers who were manning the talk to Phil performance and working with a script, which is actually very similar to how most supposed avatars are run online. This is Anna from IKEA, who I spoke to at length to find out that she was, in fact, someone sitting in a call center somewhere. The sort of last phase for Agnes and Phil, for the moment, is part of this exhibition, Software Hard Problem, curated by Morgan Quaintance, on at Cubic Gallery right now. And it was really great because Morgan's proposal had to do with making an exhibition that wasn't about anxiety. And I took that to heart and created essentially 2 server boxes, storage cases, for all the data that has been accumulated thus far by Agnes and Phil, with the intentions of putting them to sleep until there are better times for us to deal with them, with the data that's been collected. This is the last thing that I'll talk about, which also opened last week at the Musée d'Almodin in Paris as part of the Co-Workers exhibition, which takes a look at artists who work within networks and collaboratively. And this project is called Working on What the Heart Wants. And it is a live stream of production for the next film that I'm working on called What the Heart Wants. And that is pretty much the way that I work. I work with a team of freelancers, some of whom I've worked with for 2 years, some of whom I work with for 2 days. And what you see is on the left screen is all the locations for the film, as soon as they have, all the rendered locations, as soon as they've been completed, they're uploaded onto that left screen. There's the center one, which is all of the characters. This is, the film is about a future time and what will constitute a human and the systems that are being put into place now that will really impact that, and this is the system. And then lastly, on the right-hand side, you have all a chat simulation of all the conversations between myself and the freelancers. So you have the location that we are, this is Skype. Then you have their user handle or whatever they wanted me to call them within the project. And then their physical location, in this case, Colombia. Yeah, and I wanted to end on that, especially because one of the things that's been most beneficial throughout in working with institutions is the innate understanding that this medium has many different materials within it. And kind of one of the most interesting things as an artist for me has been pushing and jumping between the different notions of lives. So it's not just a platform that you click and then something happens. There are many different ways to access and to include both spaces in the same place for people to be present within them.
I think it's quite obvious already. I think when you see the first images that somehow I come from the other side, because I'm quite a traditional art historian and exhibition maker, and my approach were quite classical from doing exhibition that I realized, I think it was around 2012, 2011, that I thought that there are a lot of different artists around who have, first of all, I realized a totally different aesthetic build up. I thought it's interesting to research that. And that leads somehow to the first exhibition, which I did at the Fridizianum 2013, which was called Speculation on Anonymous Materials. And doing this research was like really checking more than 109 artistical positions and doing 45 studio visits were quite intense. And I think there were already, it was quite obvious that at this time there haven't been done really an overview on that maybe movement. And it was also quite difficult to name it, because nowadays, as we are in such a neoliberal time, I didn't want to use any terms of like post-internet or digital native, which were already around, because I saw that's too simple, too under complex, and I didn't want to show something different and then already make it as a product. And during this time of the studio visit, I realized, and it was somehow wonderful new that, or not new, but several of the artists were totally into speculative realism or so-called new realism, this already mentioned philosophical movement, which I maybe explain in the end of my talk, have, I think, a lot of in common in the way of artistic approach or thinking. And so we named that exhibition after a lot of discussions. For example, one was also Digital Neighbor, but then I thought it's more open to call it Speculation on Anonymous Materials, as all different kind of artistic position, which is somehow in the contrast, I think, what we just discussed the whole time until now, a really material-based thinking. And I think in a Speculation on Anonymous Materials, there were like three topics. The one was, which were also mentioned before, a different dealing with images, a different dealing with stock images, and also this notion that being in a time with so many images already there, it's maybe quite interesting to use that images which are already there. The second one was quite, I think, surprisingly, how much the importance of the body in the different works. And the third one were how much the language have been changed. And doing that first exhibition, I think it became quite obvious that this is a quite huge topic, whereas the first exhibition was more like an overview. The second one, which we are already in right now, were like a closer look to one part of that, which is called Nature After Nature, and was about how much the idea of nature changed in a time where we maybe assume there's no division between culture and nature, and everything is culture, or what I would prefer to say, everything is nature. That was the second show. And the last show, which called Inhuman, was more approaching, where also Cecily B. Evans were in with her movie, which she mentioned right now, and Hyper Objects. And this was more related to different vision of the human, besides the human, or thinking the human beyond the human, thinking the human beyond gender and borders of race and social borders, and trying to think the human out of the context, or the world out of the context of neuroscience, which a lot of artists are at the moment dealing with, as neuroscience somehow is a science where art doesn't really exist. So I think it's quite interesting to get into that as, for example, I'm, and I think most of the artists are quite critical with neuroscience, but I think it's interesting to get involved with that. And the third one, which were also visible in Inhuman, were their, how much their through social economic change, our body, our way of moving and feeling and thinking changed. And so what brought all this together, maybe in this context of this new thinking, is I think it was for me really a relief to break somehow mid-modernity. The idea, for example, to think the human beside the human, or think the world beside the human, because maybe I cut it a bit down. Breaking with modernity, which also means like trying to getting apart from seeing the human as the center of the universe, and I think this is where inhuman is also linked to nature after nature, because a lot of problems we have nowadays is because we see the world only from the human perspective. And I think you just, here's the nice work by Anne Cailly, where she's more dealing with bacteriums, which are much older than us and maybe influence our life much more than we think, at least as neuroscience thinks. And also, to try to get away from yourself. So one title also for speculation of anonymous materials were D-Self, because I think, also Lauren already said, which irritated me in the beginning of my research, was really the ambiguity of a lot of works, because you don't know where's the position. And I think that's quite interesting, because it's not so much about the position of the author or the position of your personal way of thinking. It's more about going out there and trying to show the complexity of the different materials, the complexity of questions. And I think the whole questioning of the digital was more something much beyond that exhibition. It was not like a topic itself, but it was like maybe in the media themselves, like doing like using it for digital printing, or in the research. But the works themselves, as I thought, told before, were quite materialized. And I think there's somehow I tried now to bring together the different ideas of all the shows, which I think were somehow really linked, and one leads into the other. And I hope now we have maybe a fruitful discussion about these different approaches. Thank you.
It was very interesting the way that certain aspects emerged throughout the different presentations of the four of you. And I was particularly interested in the ways in which both preservation and exhibition seem to be elements that continue to emerge throughout the different presentations. And I would perhaps start by making a couple of questions, and then I would open to a conversation between all of us. I think there are some microphones there, there will be. And I would actually start with Suzanne and with this group of three exhibitions, and thinking about the exhibition as a format, no? And in the way that, as a format, how can it not so much translate, but how can it share and show concerns and forms and images and dialogues that more often than not are not entirely done in the making of things, but are done by conversations, by online exchanges, by making things digitally, while your exhibitions, of course, have present works that have a very evident objectual nature, and that was mostly your intention, you know, and its relation to the body and bodily fluids and so on. So I was wondering, throughout the making of these three shows, how did these shows led you to think the exhibition as a possible format to reflect on the digital as such, and the influence of the digital in our daily lives and our relation to technology, if this makes sense as a question.
I think for me, maybe it's not really answering that question, but I think doing that exhibition made also clear, and it was a long research, because in the beginning there were a lot of also works which I thought could be interesting, which were really more internet-based and maybe in the internet, which was funny because at those time we were just building up a new website, and I thought it's also strange then to work with that. And in the end, I think we did a classical show, and I think being there with your body is really the experience you have to have, and I'm totally believing in doing exhibition. And a lot of people, which shows the distance, is that a lot of people who see the show said that they say, oh, it's even better than we thought from the images. And there's this, which is quite interesting nowadays, the comparison with the documentation of the exhibition. And this is what really changed doing exhibition. I even had this argument with one of the artists. I didn't understand why the artists were putting certain works, and it didn't make sense in the space. And I said, why are you doing it like that? And he said, oh, I would like to photograph this two series separated from each other. And I said, oh, yeah, but this is maybe something we can think later on, but I think now we just have to think how it works in the space. But I think everybody nowadays is already about thinking about documenting the work. And I think it was maybe not visible, but part of the architecture in the exhibition, we're trying also to have this, which is quite an important issue for a lot of artists, to bring the third dimensional space in the exhibition towards a two dimensional space. And this we also tried in the architecture. So I'm trying the way we put walls and pedestals, and was also to trying to see Friedrichshafen, which is a three-dimensional space, as a two-dimensional space. And things like that, I think, were involved, and I think they are nowadays involved for everybody who's doing works and doing exhibition. And this we try to reflect in the exhibition.
Mm. It's very interesting to think of an exhibition of a possible site of a flatland. Mm. But Laura, I think that you also have similar concerns, or you've also been thinking a lot of how to translate all that you have been doing, and that in the past years has been, it has a life that is publicly shared mm-hmm. online. And how are you thinking your processes of exhibition making in relation to this as a series of platforms that exist digitally when moving to space? And
I think that, in the past, we've been given kind of narrow limitations as far as this is your space, this is the month, this is what we can do, so you have to kind of work within those and create a sort of framework that for us makes sense, that, in space and also online, it's never, or vice versa, maybe oftentimes our ideas start online and then they become something physical as well. And I think that's something that more and more artists are doing. Now, many artists are still very concerned with form and taking up space and doing something material and physical, or making something immaterial or absent, real, but then there's a return to online at the same time. So it's kind of this interesting feedback loop, and I think that DIS plays into that, DIS magazine, all the different platforms kind of work towards, increasing, I think, the collapse of these two things,
And also, because something I was also wondering was in terms of audiences, and it's so interesting when you were speaking, because you have the sense that there is an overlap between the contributors, a big overlap between contributors and audience.
Definitely.
Of this. And how does this is resolved when you're working with a space and therefore with a community that mm-hmm. can be of people who travel there, but it's mostly a local community?
I mean, we've had, I think we always try. It's always, for us, it's always about finding a nice mixtures and complements, to things. So we really love seeing, like a panel like this happen, right before you have Total Freedom DJ, and having these kinds of collisions of worlds and people and communities, because I think that's kind of the strength in DIS, is though that you can, we can, we really, really love all culture, you know, like in like a very like in a horizontal way, and we're not afraid of entertainment, and we like, you know, we like humor and cult and entertainment and music and fashion and art, and it's really just sort of this this like horizontal plane that goes out and out and out and stretches, and there's no barriers, you know. So that's something that, you know, for the biennial, that's a challenge, you know, to figure out how to incorporate everything that you love into one thing, you know, especially when exhibition, there's a certain, you know, rules of engagement when you go to a museum or an institution or a place, basically, you know, to look at something, yeah. You know? So, yeah. I don't know if I answered you. Yeah.
Cecile, maybe you want to grab on that, and because when you were presenting your projects, what we saw is that there is a migration of something that you did, that you conceived to have mostly an online life, no, and to exist in the internet, and then suddenly that existence also appears in the space, no? And how does this, do you already think of how, of the life, the disconnected life of your projects?
I mean, all the time. The biggest question is, like, at what point do you make people leave their house? And why are you making them leave their house? And like, what are the best conditions for that? And there's things like hyperlinks, or it didn't happen, is not online. That needs an installation. It needs a home. It needs other works around it in order to give life to this universe and the issues and inhuman agents that are within that. I mean, Agnes is a super tricky one. I mean, I was really hesitant to bring a desktop computer into an institution and make people sit at it. That's why they're paid in coffee. It's like an acknowledgement, you left your house, but then that's the only way to help them archive it and to bring it through. And that's sort of the biggest consideration, is like, who is coming to this? Where have they been possibly before? Where do they have to go afterwards? And like, how, even just for video, can I, with the place that I'm showing it at, put forward the best possible conditions for them to experience this work, to make it as easy as possible for them for what I'm about to just hurl at them.
Yeah. Thank you. And I would perhaps move a little bit and grab on your presentation on Rhizome, because being responsible for preserving and archiving so many projects, Rhizome has this major responsibility of also being able to preserving and archiving itself. No? Rhizome being all those things. And I was wondering if in the gestures of hosting and of preserving all these different projects, you're also thinking about your own forms of continuity and existence in the future, and reinvention and afterlife, let's say. Like Cecile's work eventually have an afterlife, and you have Phil talking to Agnes. And
Well, I just, maybe on the previous point, I just want to say, which is interesting, is that the kind of nuance between quote unquote online and offline has been a place where I've seen practice being, like, art practice and art institutions being much more advanced than the kind of conversations maybe in criticism. Because I still think, like, 2015 was like a year when digital dualism was this term that was kind of being hammered into people, and this idea that there, you know, that if you referred to, like, quote unquote the digital in a tweet or something, you could get yelled at for referring to something as though it's not like part of real space or have an infrastructure or something like that. Yeah, but then I think that that's something where I've seen a lot of nuance in practice, institutional practice, in people kind of trying to figure out exactly, well, what does it mean to install a show where it maybe has this circulation as part of it, but then also is like very much a real space, or what does it mean to require someone to leave their house and make that decision? What does it mean for disk to exist in various forms? So I think that it's really exciting that that's brought up. And I think that one of the spaces of distinction between that is this like really unique and field-specific question of digital preservation, like you were referring to. And for us, it's been with us since 1999, actually since 1996, you know, when Mark founded Rhizome, they decided from the beginning to keep the conversations that were part of this mailing list. So preservation has been kind of, and this idea of the institution having this memory has been crucial since the beginning, even before maybe the full understanding of how fragile and how difficult to maintain anything is on the internet, or on the World Wide Web. And yeah, so I mean, I do think that it has been this engine for us, both in terms of, you know, I think when the art base was created in 1999, I think it was in reaction to that fragility, but also in reaction to like an inability of maybe contemporary institutions to deal with the practices that it was engaging with. And so that was a reinvention. And as we've reapproached, we're relaunching rhizome.org actually in the coming weeks, and we've been thinking a lot about what Rhizome is, and digital preservation has been part of that, as part of that reinvention, both in terms of archiving what came before, but then also just as this kind of like engine for our research looking ahead. Yeah. So,
but everything is exclusively digitally archived. This I'm asking because some time ago I was reading this interview with Ken Jacobs, and he was saying that the paradox is that when, if you want to assure the preservation of a digital video, the only one way that you have 100% sure that you will preserve it is to transfer it to film. Mm-hmm. And I enjoyed very much this idea that you need to turn it to a material that you would consider to be obsolescence in order for it to archive. So yeah. You're not printing.
No, I mean, I think that's interesting. I mean, when the art base was also created, it was kind of going back to that point I was making about like gatekeepers and the history of like this idea of the gatekeeper. It was open accession. So people would turn over their kind of materials, and either it would be like a link to a site, or it could be a fully cloned version of that. And so there are like a lot of different types of materials in it. And I think our focus right now, because there's 2,000 and because we're only 5 or 6 staffers, depending on what day of the week you catch us, it is about kind of finding broad-based solutions to these problems. So yeah, we're not going as far as the Ken Jacobs solution.
I visited a time capsule in Atlanta, Georgia, that's not meant to be opened for another like 6,000 years. And they have, it's in the basement of a university that has since like sprouted and grown around it. And I went and visited with my partner, and we were speaking with them and looking at the images. And they had things like the gramophone and other various things. But included in it, they had a fully independently, presumably operational, electric generator that would make the thing work. And so included in the time capsule is all of the different elements that you would need to kind of time travel back to that system. And I just thought that was just such an interesting thing to have thought that at that time. And also how earnest and modest to understand that like this amazing time that I want to preserve could get more amazing, or might not always be the system that's in place.
Yeah.
I think it's really useful to think about.
Yeah, that's cool.
We were meant to be closing now, so maybe I will open. I hope we don't have to close right now. No, okay. So, but perhaps we can share it. And
I was actually just going to make one more point to that about this kind of like ecosystem that you need to have the generator to basically be able to operate some of the materials, at least if I understand that story. And it is like one of the challenges, and this is something where there's an interesting continuity, is that, you know, when I think about, you know, what we're looking at, we're like, when we talk about archival work, it's like histories of dependencies. And how do you make something depend, like how do you slim that dependency to make it work best for an artist or a practice or a mission or that kind of thing? And I think that there's like historical boundaries for that. I mean, I think that like the historical practices known as like institutional critique are really interesting as being this kind of like analog idea of like addressing kind of like a history of dependencies. And I mean, these are kind of things that, I just bring that up just by virtue of saying that these aren't, I hate when there's like this break and like digital is new or something like that. But then also to say that like, when you're in the mode of preservation, you're in the mode of like preserving systems and preserving,
but
like,
I think,
yeah. Yeah.
But
it's a
zoo. The funny thing is, on the one hand, as more as you document or preserve it, more it get lost. Yeah. And I think it's like, what would be the mathematical symbol, but I think that's quite interesting also in the context, just to think about that we have electricity since 100, how many years, but it's everything's so recent in the end, if you see it like, because I think I never mentioned in a talk before that I'm an art historian, But being here, I really had the feeling that, okay, there's so many other historical distances where you could think about what's happening right now, which would somewhat change it.
I mean, it's also important to introduce the idea, and like I can say this for Agnes, like there was a discussion at some point, do you want her to be remembered and how? I mean, it got very personal and it was like, yeah, maybe, you know, it just like things move on and it just gets swallowed up as this thing that people experienced at that time. But even then that becomes, then I swallow that back into the work because you have issues that are ancient, like what is a memory and does it exist independent of the, you know, the people who experienced it and how can that live on and things like that. I mean, there's, it's a really rich topic because there's so many different angles to come at it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, for sure. Hello.
Hello, Zachary, I just had a question because I used to work at Rhizome ages ago, but I was involved with the art base actually for 2 years. I just had a question. Right now, what are you guys doing in terms of making those objects available? Are you migrating these mm-hmm. cloned objects now, or are you trying to recreate the systems, the original systems on which they were intended to be played back or used or interacted with? Because I'm just thinking, the Guggenheim and John Ippoletto did this exhibition where they really did that. It was a huge undertaking, and I'm just wondering what steps you guys have mm-hmm. in place for this art base now.
Yeah, we have like a lot of different, we have a number of approaches. One is emulation software, and basically this is like a practice eventually of like software curation, being able to like match a given artwork. Let's just say, here's the class I was giving earlier, but like Jodi.org, foundational kind of like work of net art. It's a great piece. It's so simple. I mean, it's like, it's just code. I mean, you could go and you could download the HTML very easily and you could represent it. However, the tag, the blink tag, which is part of it, which makes the thing kind of have this belligerent blinking, and that hasn't been realized since, or hasn't been recognized by any modern browser since 2006, I think, because, you know, designers said that was not cool and it was part of the vernacular web and we shouldn't remember that history. But so like a solution for a work like that, which is as maybe as simple as it gets in certain ways, is about creating an emulation environment or having an emulation environment where that can just be ported in and then connected to the Internet Explorer, or I guess, well, I guess Netscape Navigator that would perform that piece. So it's actually like thinking through things as performance and thinking how best to perform it. You could go through and preserve meticulously every single object, but there's only five or six of us and there's only Dragon Espenscheid, our digital conservator, leading the program. So you need to kind of think at a systems level. And then future-proofing that, I mean, this web recorder thing that I mentioned at the end, that is like a, I can explain it to you in more detail maybe afterwards, but it's a really innovative way to capture something like Facebook where it's infinitesimally, or is that the correct, way more complex than, you know, Jodi.org, yet still have it accessible in a pretty easy way for one person at home without coffee. Yeah.
Many. Shall we start by these two in the front and then move?
Thank you. I don't know if it's slightly provocative to ask this question in the Goethe-Institut, but I feel like the way that you talk about or define institutionality really is a lot about exhibition making and preservation predominantly. But I wonder what any of you think about this kind of institutionality as an essentially or potentially elitist structure or a violent structure or oppressive structure like we know it from through history. Is that something we should still consider? Has the institution changed, or is it more the way that people use it in the digital or online? I wonder if any of you have any thoughts on that.
I'm not answering your question. I'm just saying that perhaps it was me who framed this institutional, this conversation more in relation to exhibition and preservation, because I thought that it was one of the threads that emerged in relation to the different preservations.
two different presentations go. I'm getting dyslexic. But perhaps someone wants to add something in relation to...
I mean, are you saying basically, like, how do we rail against it, like the traps of freedom?
No, I just mean that the institution is a structure of governance in a
sure.
way, and it's something that we all have to deal with as people,
yeah.
people working in culture, both as artists, people working within the institutions. And I wonder if these sort of concerns, for example, the concerns of institutional critique, are these still relevant, or do we need to sort of rephrase those considerations when thinking about institutionality as a digital phenomenon?
I think artists deal with that all the time. And I think even people within the institutions, especially on a curatorial level, deal with it all the time. Mm. And in the best case scenario, work together to go against the structures that have been in place for a very long time, which to some extent is no single person's fault. It's just the nature of the being, and things like bureaucracy, things like health and safety even come
yeah,
into
exactly.
play. Like
that's what I mean,
if
yeah.
you have a piece that's living, it's just happened last week, you have a piece that's living, the cables need to be visible. The physical aspects of it need to be acknowledged. And then how do you work within the institutional framework, but also how does this not, I mean, something that happens all the time that artists discuss is like how not to historicize this before it's happened or before it's been given the air. Like someone talks about like MIDI, the keyboard, the synthesized sound, mm-hmm. and how that structure was built in such a way that people have to kind of work around it in order to experiment with it, and like how as it happens. And I think artists don't want to have to think about this, but at some point, you know, these are issues that come up, and hopefully, like, again, best case scenario, there are things that people are comfortable to talk about and to say, you know, I mean, I've been asked if I can show the Agnes, The End Is Near on a USB stick, because it'd be a lot easier, because the Wi-Fi is just not that strong. And it's like, you know, yeah, it would be a lot easier for me too. I wouldn't have to be here. Like, but that's not the work. And I think that is definitely something that everyone thinks about as it goes along. How do we treat these? And I'm repeating myself, but it's so important. Like each thing as a particular material, and each bit of it is a contributor to the piece, kind of thing.
And I think what is quite surprising also, or which was surprising for me, doing that exhibition, that it's also quite, it's a different media, but you always, as what you said, an institution, you have to fight against the institution, otherwise the institution is dead. But in the end, I think also the way of presentations are also quite classical. And what I said before, that the materialization, at least of the work we have chosen to show, which is, as always, also in selection, were also quite physics, and the way they were shown were surprisingly classical.
Mm. But I think that the way that you frame that question is interesting too, because it kind of presumes that there's sort of an inside and an outside to everything.
Yeah.
And I think that, at least from my standpoint, there is not, you know? And yeah.
Yeah, and
yeah.
that's...
I would agree.
And
I would just add to that too. Yeah, I mean, I would echo that point exactly. Like, I think of like Andrea Fraser's, you know, from the institution of critique of institutions to the institution to institutions of critique, and it's something I always assign when I like go speak at a program about digital art or something, because like you need to like have this basis that like we all have a vested kind of network relationship to these things. Yeah, and I do think it's like worth asking these questions. My colleague Michael Connor, who's our artistic director, he wrote a piece in 2010 or 2011 called Gatekeepers for the 21st Century. And it is like a really kind of like solid historical, as he always is, solid historical, thoughtful take on basically what it means to be an institution at an age where you're still an institution, and that violence is inherently part of your proposition, and yet you're being circulated by, or you're being surrounded by like a proliferation of what I would say is little institutions, but also just voices, and about how the responsibility of the institution is to manage and to tend and to support those kind of voices and be responsive to them, yeah.
And you have, I mean, DIS is a great platform for this, because I feel like for many artists, like, this is where you go when it's like you just want to do something and it doesn't really fit into anything, and also you want to reach out to like a more diverse audience and things like that. I mean, I think there are networks building up outside and inside
throughout that are crossing over in this time that we're making things that are protecting that.
I might have a question for the panelists too, which relates to that, which is about this idea of independence. Mm-hmm. And this is something that I think has really changed from like when Rhizome was founded, and especially with institutionalizing the digital. It's like back in the day, you know, there's this idea that you had to be hosted on a like-minded server, or you had to like host, you had to, Rhizome was involved with that. We were selling server space, all this kind of thing. But of course now our audience, you know, we used to have a really exciting, and we still do have a comment section, but it's like fallen off in a different way. People now comment on Facebook, which is something where in the making of this book, I had to like answer the question, like, is Facebook an institution? And like, I think not, I think it's a platform. But like, you still have to opt in and participate in these things. And DIST does that in a really direct way. And like, you know, you do that in a very particular way with, hosting Agnes on YouTube. I just like think it's really interesting. And of course, at an institutional level, you're always being pressured to like engage with, I don't know, protect your independence while reaching audiences, this kind of thing. I just wonder if there were reactions to that, because I saw it coming up. This kind of question of independence and where your platform can live and how it can live.
I don't exactly know how to answer that, but like I said in my talk, I think DIST came from kind of a different time. I mean, launching in 2010, it was a very different place back then, you know, like Instagram didn't exist and like we were like afraid of tweeting too much. It was just like a very different thing. And we also believed when we started that we would be outsiders, you know, and never expected to be on a panel or any of this really, you know, to be honest. So, I think it's good for the energy, you know, to feel that way for a while. But then now we've come to a place where it's almost like we've crossed over or something in this really strange way like that, you know, and you question everything then. Everything gets redetermined, you know, what your new mission is or what's the purpose of doing this. And you even see it, I mean, I think we see it online too, because in the very beginning, you know, we only had our friends seeing our work and commenting and whatever, so you had this very supportive small micro network, you know. But now, you know, you have a larger audience and you kind of have a different a very different relationship, you know, with that. That's, yeah, it's harder, you can't go back. Mm-hmm. You know.
Mm-hmm. Cross the line.
Kind of, yeah. You know.
And of course, it's still too early to talk about this, but for instance, because you mentioned independence, but also largely audiences, no, and participation. And for instance, in Art Agenda, we decided to close our comment section because it was mostly used by algorithms trying to sell Louis Vuitton, Rolex watches, whatever. And we imagined the future in which they will be selling them to one another. and this coincided, and this is just I told that to Cecile when we met recently, but coincided to a moment in which my grandmother passed away, and a couple of months after, I received an email from my grandmother trying to sell something, like junk. And that was very uncanny, but also allowed me to have a sort of hope of a afterlife via my email communicating with your email and so on. So I think it's interesting to, apart from this very morbid short story, to imagine circulation, participation, diffusion that goes beyond our physical human engagement with things, and will eventually there will be forms of intelligence communicating. And
they definitely are already. But there's an amazing Rainer Maria Rilke quote, "What if all the dragons in our lives are just princes and princesses that want to be loved?" And I always think about this in terms of like all these spam bots and like these things that we just consider to be really annoying. It's like, what if you listen to the noise? What happens? I mean, maybe there's nothing. And like, it's a very weird thing to say, actually. But
yeah,
I don't know how much I stand behind that. It was just a thought that I had listening to that.
Well, let's go for it. There's a question here. We'll have one here, and there was one at the back, and then I think we need to close.
This is a question about Agnes.
It's working.
Okay, this is a question about Agnes. Actually, is the intention to simulate artificial life, to have a human control over it, or have you considered kind of tools to introduce artificial life to her to maybe preserve herself outside of the institution, for example?
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Yeah.
I mean,
it exists.
Great. But one thing early on that was really important was, like, I didn't want it to be about the technique with Agnes. I just wanted people to have the experience. It was a time when there was a lot of conversation. It's before Elon Musk and everyone started their council against artificial intelligence, because they're all going to destroy us, just like the history of cinema. And I just wanted people not to have to worry about how it works, and for me to take care of that, and especially also to change the duration of time that people spent with these kinds of projects. So knowing that they, in order to properly engage with Agnes, it's not even just the 10 minutes that you have on your first user journey, it's the 10 minutes that you have then again at 2 a.m. It's the 10 minutes at, you know, whatever. It's the conversations that could potentially emerge as people talk to one another and had completely, some people only know Agnes goes live, some people only know this thing. And at the moment, that is a very human thing to put together. And I just was concerned about the, like, of building an intelligence, and it is a kind of intelligence. The software pulls content live based on, you know, the information that you give it. But I really wanted the experience to be within the user, and that was the best possible solution, was for me to control it on the outside, I guess.
And it's the last question, I'm afraid.
Zach alluded to the idea that the radical potential of understanding art in its circulation would have been to see a reconfiguring of the gallery as just one node in a broader network of distribution. And it seems as though that hasn't really happened, in that the gallery remains the primary site of spectatorship, with only the image of networks being produced for gallery-bound spectatorship. So and practices like that of DIS, for example, remain definitely the exception in terms of the field of new art. So thinking broadly about the field beyond your individual practices, how hopeful is the panel about that radical potential?
Shall we speak before and then have an official?
I would just say that, you know, I mean, that quote, which is a really good quote, and it's and from this interview in Spike with Ben and Alex Scrimmager, which I really like. I mean, the point of that is that it's a node in a network. I don't know. I mean, I kind of go back to that, like, you know, like institutions of critique kind of thing, where it's like, I don't know if I would phrase it as like surpassing my practice or like anyone's practice as like related to a history of art and the gallery. I think that it's amazing, and what the potential is when something happens like this, and when something happens, you know, in a different way and new frisions are allowed to exist. But I don't know if it's like necessarily a progress or something. I didn't take that away from the quote.
I mean, if it's directed to me, I mean, I really think that there's going to be, in the future, there's going to be, you know, obviously a strengthening of these, like, you know, like platforms like DIS or whatever, you know, and I think we'll continue to see more and more of that. I don't know if it's going to wind up being like artform versus artform.com, you know, where it's just like you have these two different independent sources of art and everything, you know, and they're just running these parallel courses, or when and if they can really like merge, you know. And I think that's for us, that's what's interesting, is if they can collapse a little bit more, you know.
Of course, I think that it's very interesting because they only exist as .com after existing so long as paper, no? So
I don't know. I think you'll see the reverse too, though. Yeah. You know, you'll see Nasty Gal, you know, as this like online e-commerce Coachella site, and then you'll see it in the mall like someday, yeah. You know? Yeah. So I think that one gives, now it's not so clear what gives birth to what, you know?
Yeah,
and in the end, I mean, DIS, the way it started was, anyway, I mean, yeah, it was an email thread, but ultimately it was a community of people that wanted to share something they were doing in real life. Mm. Sorry, I said it. But, you know.
Yeah. Do we need to close? Yes, I think so. Okay. We need to close. Thank you very much. Thank you for Goethe-Institut opening times, for hosting us, for inviting us. Thank you for your time in this busy week. And maybe we can continue beyond this division. And yeah, have a nice weekend.